So to talk about the third method we discussed today, I'm going now to talk about belief propagation. So this is the final method around collective classification we are going to talk in this lecture. And really, this will be all about what is called message passing, right? We can think of these methods that we have talked about so far all in terms of kind of messages, beliefs being sent over the edges of the network, a node receiving these messages, updating its own belief so that in the next iterations, its neighbors are able to get this new information and update their own beliefs as well. So this is basically what is the core intuition we are trying to explore today, which is all about passing information across the neighbors, either pushing it or receiving it and updating the belief about oneself. And the algorithm that does this is also known as loopy belief propagation. Loopy because we will apply it to graphs that may have cycles, and belief propagation because these messages, these beliefs are going to be passed over the edges of the network. So let me give you a bit of context and where does this notion of loopy belief propagation come from. Belief propagation is a dynamic programming approach to about answering the probabilistic queries in a graph, right? By probabilistic queries, I mean, you know, computing the probability that a given node belongs to a given class. And it's an iterative process in which the neighboring nodes talk to each other by passing messages to each other. And, you know, the way you can think of this is really like, you know, if there wouldn't be COVID, we'd be nicely sitting in school. And, you know, you can pass messages between one another if you are, you know, sit close together or if you are connected in the network, right? So node V will say, I believe you that you belong to this class one with the following likelihood. And then a given node can then collect these beliefs from its neighbors and say, aha, this now makes me more sure or less sure I also belong to class one. And when this consensus is reached, as these messages are being passed around, we arrive to the optimum, we arrive to the kind of the final belief about the class or label of every node in the network. So let me show you some basics about message passing, and we are first going to do this on simple graphs, we are going to do this on a line graph, then we are going to generalize this to a tree type graph, and then we are going to apply this to general graphs. And just for simplicity, let's assume we want to count the number of nodes in a graph using message passing, right? So each node can only interact, meaning it can only pass messages with its neighbors, right? Other nodes it is connected to. So, you know, as I said before, note that there might be issues if the graphs contain cycles, but for now, let's assume there are no cycles or let's ignore the cycles, right? So the idea is I have a line graph, I have nodes 1 to 6 linked in this type of linear structure. So the task is that we want to compute or count the number of nodes in the graph. And the way how we can do this using message passing is that we define some ordering on the nodes, right? And this ordering, let's say, results in a path. And then edge directions, we can think of them according to the ordering of the nodes, right? So, and this edge direction determines the order in which messages are being passed. So let's say we consider nodes in order 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the messages will start at 1 and be passed to node 6. And the way these messages will go is that node I will compute the message. And then, you know, the message will be sent from node I to node I plus 1. And the idea will be that as the message passes to the node, a node gets to look that message, may transform it, and pass it on. So if now we want to go back to this task of counting the number of nodes in the graph, the idea here is simple, right? Each node can only interact with its members, its neighbors can only pass messages. And the idea is that each node says, but however many nodes are in front of me, I also add myself to the count and pass on this message to the next node. So this means that each node listens to the messages from its incoming neighbors, updates the message, and passes it forward. And we will use the letter M to denote the message. Right, so for example, the way to think of this, node 1 will say, oh, there is one of me, and then it will pass this message M to the neighbor number 2. Neighbor number 2 is going to get the incoming message and say, oh, there is one node in front of me, but there is me here as well. So this means there are two nodes so far. So it will update the belief that there are, you know, M plus 1 messages ahead of it. And then it's going to send this message forward. The message will now have value 2. And then node 3 is going to collect this message with value 2, update it. It will say, oh, there's me as well. So it will add 1 plus to it. So it will become a 3. And it will send it on. And this way, you know, like when we arrive to node 6, we will be counting the number of nodes on the path, because every node increases the message value by 1 and passes it on. So at the end, you know, the final belief of node 6 will be that there are 6 nodes in the graph. And then, we could even like now take this message and pass it back to the beginning node 1. But the main idea here is that each node collects a message from its neighbor, updates it, and passes it forward. That's the core operation that I wanted to illustrate here. And you can see how this works nicely on a line graph with the proper ordering of the nodes. Now, we can do the same algorithm also on a tree, right? If we have a graph that has this acyclic tree-like structure, then we can perform message passing not only on a path graph, but also on a tree-structured graph. The important thing here is to propagate or do the message passing from the leaves to the root of the node, of the tree. So the idea is, right, that first leaves 5, 6, and 7, number 2 will say, oh, we are one, I'm one node, I'm the first node, and we'll set the message value to 1, and then they will send messages to their parents, right, who are here above them. And then the parents are going to sum up the values of the messages from the children, add 1 to it, and pass that message on. And then again, recursively, the next level, you know, it's going to sum up the incoming. Here it will be 2 plus 1, it's 3, plus 1 for itself, it's 4 to send it on. And then this here is going again to sum up 1 plus 4 is 5, plus itself equals to 6. And there should be 6 messages here. Actually, it should be 7, so I lost a count of 1 somewhere. But you get the idea, right? So the idea is to say, I am one descendant I send information on, I'm one descendant I send it on. This one sums the messages, adds 1 to them, and says, oh, there is 3 of us, let me send this forward, right? So there will be a value of 3 here. There will be, similarly, here it will be a value of 1, so there will be 1 plus 3 is 4, plus 1 is 5, so there will be 5 here. There is 1 descendant here, so the 2 together will be 6, plus 1 for this node. At the end, the final belief will be that there is 7 nodes in the graph. Again, the basic information in this algorithm is this local message computation, where messages come in, they get collected by the node collects them, processes the messages, creates a new message, and sends it on. So the loopy belief propagation algorithm, what it does, it, if you say what message will be sent from node I to node j, it will depend on what node I hears from its neighbors, right? The content of this message here is going to depend on the incoming messages from its downstream neighbors. So each neighbor passes a message to I. I will now take these messages, collect them, compute them, update them, create a new message, and then send this new message to node J. And that's essentially what loopy belief propagation does. The way we can think of this a bit more formally is the following. We are going to have what is called label-label potential matrix. So here we are going to capture dependencies between a node and its neighbor in terms of labels. And you can think of this as a one way to say is what is the if node I has label y and node j has, you know, some other label y sub j, then the label potential matrix, the entry at that cell will be the proportion or will be proportional to the probability that node j belongs to class y sub j, given that its neighbor I belongs to class y sub I. So this means that here, if homophily is present, this matrix will have high values on the diagonal, meaning if j belongs to class 1, then I should also belong to class 1. But given that we have this label potential matrix, if there are big values of the diagonal, this will mean that, you know, if my neighbor is of class 1, then I am likely to be of class 0. So it also can capture the cases where the actually nodes that are connected are of the opposite labels, are of the opposite classes. So that's this label potential matrix that tells us if a node J is of one label, how likely am I of a different or of some other type of label if I'm node I. Then we are also going to have this phi, which is the prior belief about what should be the label of node I. So, right, so phi of yi is proportional to the probability, prior probability of node I belonging to class yi. And then we'll have this notion of a message, where message goes from node I to node j. And this means that this is I's message or estimate of node y being in class y sub j. And L will be the set of all class labels. So to give you now the formula, first in the initial iteration, in the initialization, we are going to initialize all messages to have value 1. And then we are going to repeat for every node the following formula, where basically we are right now at node I, and we'd like to compute the message that we are going to send to node J. And this message will be I's belief that J belongs to a given class. So the way we are going to do this is to say, okay, let's sum over all the states or over all the possible labels. Let's take the belief that I belongs to a given label. And this is the belief, this is the potential that J will belong to the label Y sub J, right? So this is the label potential matrix that I have introduced in the previous slide. Now we are going to multiply that with a prior probability of node I belonging to class y sub I. And now here, what we are doing is we are going to sum over all the neighbors k of node I, omitting the j. J is the node to which we are sending the message. So we are summing over everyone but j, or multiplying over everyone but j, where now for every neighbor k here, these three neighbors, we are asking, what is your belief about node y being in class y sub I, right? So now basically what this means is that node I collects beliefs from its downstream neighbors, aggregates the beliefs, multiplies with its belief what its own class should be, And then applies the label potential matrix to now send a message to node J about how I's label should influence J's label. And this is the core of loopy belief propagation, right? And we can keep iterating this equation until we reach some convergence, right? When basically we collect messages, we transform them and send that message onward to the next level neighbor, right? And after this approach, this iteration is going to converge. We will have the belief about what is the likelihood or probability of node I belonging to a given class or to a given label y sub I. And essentially, the way this will look like is that our belief will be a product of the prior belief about what's the label of that node times the messages of what other nodes downstream here labeled as J, think about what the label of node I is, and this is encoded in these messages. So this is the idea how belief propagation algorithm works. Here I call it loopy belief propagation because in practice people tend to apply this algorithm to graphs that have cycles or loops as well, even though then any kind of convergence guarantees and this kind of probabilistic interpretation that I gave here gets lost. So if you consider graphs with cycles, right, there is no longer a fixed ordering of the nodes, which is otherwise the fixed ordering exists in terms if the graphs are trees. But if a graph has a cycle, you cannot sort the nodes in a nice order. And basically the idea is that we apply the same algorithm as in the previous slides, but we start from arbitrary nodes and then follow the edges to update the messages. So basically we kind of propagate this in some kind of a random order, again, until it converges or until some fixed number of iterations is reached. So to give you an idea how this would look like, for example, on a graph with cycles, the issue becomes that if our graph has cycles, messages from different subgraphs, from different sub-branches, are no longer independent, right? So it means that, for example, when our graph was a tree, we could say, oh, let's collect information from the left child, from the right child, and add it up and send it to our parent. So it means that kind of children don't talk to each other, and these messages really are coming from disjoint parts of the tree. However, if there is a cycle, then this idea of something being disjoint or independent is no longer true, right? Like, for example, when node U would collect messages, it would collect message from I and K, but really these messages are no longer independent because they both depend on the message they got from J. So in this sense, in some sense, J is talking to U twice, once through I and once through K. So this creates problems in terms of theory and in terms of convergence. But what people tend to do in practice and what works really well in practice is that you still run this belief propagation even though the graph has cycles, right? And here what I try to show you is that once you are in a cycle, kind of the information will amplify artificially because it gets on a cycle. And this is similar, if you think about it, to when we talked about PageRank and we talked about spider traps, right? That where the random walker kind of gets infinitely lost in this spider trap. It starts cycling. And the problem with cycles or with loops is that these messages start cycling again as well. So the problem in this case, if the graph has cycles, is that beliefs may not converge. Message is based on initial belief of I and not on separate kind of independent evidence coming from nodes I. So the initial belief about I, which could be incorrect, is reinforced, through the cycle in this case. However, as I said, in practice, loopy belief propagation is still very good heuristic for complex graphs, because complex real-world networks tend to be more like trees and they tend to have a relatively small number of cycles. So the cycles in reality are not such a big problem as there might be in this kind of worst-case scenarios. And to give you an example, right, imagine we are doing belief propagation and we have two states. We have a state or a true or a false. And now, you know, this node here sends a message to the following node and says, you know, I think you are true with, you know, with my belief about you being true is 2 and my belief about you being false is 1. So now this node will take this and pass it on. And this is now kind of going to be, let's say, updated or passed on in a cycle. But when it comes back to this node is now going to collect messages from both of incoming messages, this message and that message. So now it will say, oh, my belief that I am true is actually 4, and my belief that I'm false is, let's say, only 1 or let's say only 2. And what this means is that now in this cycle, this is going to kind of to amplify. And the cycle is going to amplify our belief that the state is actually true. So this means that messages loop around and around and are more and more convinced that these variables actually have state true and not state false. And belief propagation kind of incorrectly will treat these messages as separate evidence that the variable t is true. And the issue is that these messages are no longer independent because there is a cycle on the graph, and this can cause problems. As I said, in practice, real graphs tend to look more like trees, so the cycles are not a problem in practice. Right? This is, as I said, an extreme example. Often in practice, the influence of cycles is weak, as cycles are long or include at least one weak correlation, so that the message strength gets broken. So, what are some advantages of belief propagation? Advantages are that it's easy to code up and it's easy to parallelize. It is general, means that we can apply any graph model with any form of potential. I showed you this label potential matrix, but you can also think of more complex higher order potentials. So this is nice because label propagation or belief propagation does not consider only homophily anymore, but can learn more complex patterns where labels change based on the labels of the neighbors, right? So far, in previous methods, we only said my label is depends on the label of my neighbor. So if whatever my neighbor preference is, my neighbor's label is, this is also my label. In belief propagation, the labels can flip because we have this notion of label affinity matrix. The challenge in belief propagation is that convergence is not guaranteed, so we generally don't know when to stop, especially if there are many closed loops. So the trick here would be to run belief propagation for a short number of steps. And of course, these potential functions, this label potential matrix, this needs to be, requires training, data analysis to be able to estimate it. So to summarize, we learned how to leverage correlations in graphs to make predictions of nodes. We talked about three techniques: relational classification, where basically we say my label is a sum of the labels from my neighbors, which basically means my label is kind of the label of my neighbors. This uses the network structure but doesn't use feature information. Then we talked about iterative classification that used both node feature information as well as the summary of the labels captured in the vector z around a given node. So this approach used both the feature information about the nodes as well as labels of the neighbors, but still kind of would depend on homophily type principle. And then we talked about loopy belief propagation that included this label potential matrix thought about this as collecting messages, transforming messages, and sending a message to the upstream neighbor as well. This process is exact and well-defined on chain graphs and on trees, but on graphs with cycles, it creates problems. However, as I said, in practice, cycles tend to be few or tend to have weak connections, so that in practice, cycles don't cause too much problem, and loopy belief propagation is a very strong algorithm or a very strong approach for semi-supervised labeling of nodes in the graph. So with this, we have finished the lecture for today.